Good afternoon from the garden and welcome to today's video, which is about our disease-resistant tomatoes trial. It's the 29th of September and the outside tomato season is definitely reaching its end. But before we pull out the plants, I wanted to share our experiences and tell you what we found out in regard to growing disease-resistant or partially disease-resistant tomato varieties outside. We live in the Netherlands in, on average, a fairly rainy climate, and that means that growing tomatoes outside has always been a challenge. The main problem that we encounter is blight or Phytophthora infestans, which is a fungus that thrives under wet weather. In fact, if the plants remain wet for 4 to 8 hours, then you're almost guaranteed that you will get disease problems, especially if the temperature is fairly low. For this reason, I mostly gave up on trying to grow tomatoes outside because it was always so heartbreaking when at the moment that they finally started to bear fruits, they also started displaying signs of disease and we had to pull them out. But in the last few years, more and more disease-resistant, blight-resistant varieties are becoming available. So I wanted to give it a try, a go again, and I ordered several disease-resistant varieties and grew them in this bed. Disease-resistant is usually based on one or two genes that were found by plant breeders in wild varieties, and in fact, up till now, the most disease-resistant variety that I've grown was Metz wild cherry tomato, which is almost a wild tomato, and it has done very well for us outside, but it was pretty much the only variety that I have had success with outside. So the varieties that I grew this year are modern hybrids, which of course means that the seeds are very expensive, and two, you cannot save seeds because they would not grow true to the variety if you sow them next year. There is some controversy about whether or not you should use hybrid seeds at all. For me, if that makes growing tomatoes outside possible for us, then it's worth it. We grew 5 modern hybrids and one tomato variety that seeds that I got from a fellow gardener who belongs to a garden club, and one of the members of the club discovered a tomato on their holiday and they kept the seeds and discovered that it had a reasonable disease resistance, so they started keeping the seeds and spreading them between the members of the garden club. Because in July and at least the first half of August, the weather here was exceptionally warm and dry, the plants had not been challenged at all in that period, so we waited a little longer with making this video so that we could really see how they cope in less than ideal circumstances. And if you watched our harvest video from the beginning of the month, on the 8th of shot on the 8th of September, I showed you this bed, and at that time the plants were almost completely fine, but you can see that it's a very different picture now, and now we can also see the difference between the varieties. So let's have a closer look at the varieties that we grew, starting with the non-hybrid, which is at the back of the bed here. Apart from this tomato, I grew all the varieties, other varieties pruned to a single stem, also in order to improve airflow and that way stimulate the plants to dry in case of wet weather and prevent disease. But this variety was given to me with a drawing of how best to grow it, and because it's a little, it grows a bit more like wild tomatoes in the way that it really branches a lot. I grew it up the trellis. These are actually two plants that I kept sort of weaving through the trellis, and you can see the tops are still fine, but mostly the plants are already looking pretty diseased. Here you can see a typical truss. They tend to branch and they have the like plum shaped. Here is one that is still good. pretty good taste, quite they don't go soft, and I think also quite good to keep, and quite resistant to splitting as well. Next, this variety is called Jasper. It was introduced in 2012, and in 2013 it got the All-American Selection Award. It's a cherry tomato with quite small cherry-sized fruits, long trusses which do not branch, very good taste, but as you can see, it is maybe the most diseased one by now. And it also was, I think, one of the first two varieties to start displaying disease problems. It is very vigorous grower, so it might also be an idea to let more branches grow. But I, as I said, I pruned all of those to single stem. Second one here is Honeymoon, which is a French variety. Large fruits, about 4 to 5 fruits per truss. You can see compared in my hand how large it is, but tendency towards splitting and also pretty diseased by now. So I don't think they actually gave us a really big harvest, because also the larger fruits tend to start ripening later, especially compared to the cherry like Jasper. But you can see that it was that the upper trusses are the ones that we are now harvesting, last ones, and actually we were, before the plants succumbed to disease, we were able to harvest most of the fruits, which is not the case here. Next, this is Damsel, which is a pink beefsteak tomato with a very good taste, and the resistance is based on two genes. That's actually the same for Honeymoon, which I think it's pretty similar to Damsel actually. Unfortunately, like the other one, it has a tendency to split, and because the fruits are so large, they start to ripen later. They can get very large if you look at this fruit, but I don't think these will get a chance to ripen anymore, maybe not even if you bring them outside. Inside I will try that, but I'm not sure it will work. They're nice to eat raw, but I also turn them into tomato sauce and ketchup, both good for that. Next, Mountain Magic, which is probably the most disease resistant in our trial, or one of the two most resistant disease. You can see the trusses are really long, medium-sized tomatoes, also some cracking, but not the weather is really bad now, so you can see that it starts to affect the plants. In this case also the resistance is based on two different genes, and the plants are also resistant to other diseases such as fusarium. Pretty good taste, and they also keep well after harvest. The last one in our trial is called Primabella. It's a German variety introduced in 2013. It's a little smaller cocktail sized fruits, I'd say, quite large trusses, does not split, which is great in this weather. And you can see it's probably the healthiest looking plant in the trial now. So definitely one that I will be growing again next year. The weather is turning for the worse, so it's time for us to wrap up this video. I hope you found it interesting and helpful. If you did, please give it a thumbs up and let me know in the comments whether you have tried growing any of these varieties or other resistant varieties. That would be also very helpful for me and interesting for other viewers if we can share this information. Happy gardening!